Hello and good evening and welcome to the late edition. I am Gautam Roy. Well, India and the US have taken another major step in their strategic partnership. The signing of the Logistics Exchange Memorandum of Agreement yesterday is one of the highlights of Defense Minister Manohar Parrikar's three-day visit to Washington, D.C. Let's get you a look at some of the details of the agreement, which remained in the pipeline for nearly 12 years, and how it will benefit the two unique strategic partners.
The U.S. has agreed to elevate defense trade and technology sharing with India to a level commensurate with its closest allies and partners. In this regard, an important agreement was inked on Monday that will allow use of each other's land, air and naval bases for repair and resupply. The Logistics Exchange Memorandum of Agreement facilitates the provision of logistical support, supplies and services between the U.S. and Indian militaries on a reimbursable basis and provides a framework to govern them. This may include food, water, billeting, transportation, petroleum, oils, lubricants, clothing, medicinal services, spare parts and components, repair and maintenance services, training services and other logistical items and services. Besides, the agreement also allows for the purchase by establishing a value for the purchase and the terms for payment, which could be replacement in kind or an equal value exchange. Meanwhile, the U.S. Defense Secretary asserted that the agreement is a landmark in military cooperation with India.
With respect to the major defense partnership agreement, that is a very substantial change. It's an enormous change from 50 years of history. And a very substantial advance over just a few months ago. And here's the gist of it. It will allow the United States and India to cooperate, which, speaking from the U.S. point of view, in a way that we do only with our closest and most long-standing allies.
Parrikar and Carter also discussed the wealth of progress in bilateral cooperation and deepening strategic partnership between the United States and India.
Our engagement on maritime security is developing well. India and the United States have a shared interest in freedom of navigation and overflight and unimpeded commerce as part of rule-based order in Indo-Pacific.
Parrikar, however, clarified that no U.S. troops will be deployed in India and the bases will be used only for berthing or refueling of each other's warships.
Doesn't have anything to do with the setting up of base. It's basically logistic support to each other's fleet, like supply of fuel, supply of many other things which are required for joint operations, humanitarian assistance, and many other relief operations.
Secretary Carter and Minister Parrikar also agreed to continue to their close consultation on Make in India proposals. Secretary Carter also welcomed India membership in the Missile Technology Control Regime and reaffirmed U.S. support for India's membership in the Nuclear Supplies Group. Bureau Report, DD News.
So a major milestone has been crossed as far as military ties between India and the U.S. Go in that partnership that has been making a very rapid progress ever since the Modi government came to power in 2014. Let's talk about this pact that has now been signed and a lot of its implications as well. We have CEO Uday Bhaskar with us. He's Director, Society for Policy Studies, a noted strategic expert. We also have Sheel Khan Sharma, former Secretary General SAARC, and of course a senior diplomat with us as well. Commodore, if I could first ask you, a lot has been interpreted in terms of what this pact really means. Some have said that it's, they've gone to the extent of saying that it's a war pact, which it's clearly not. So let's just first understand what it is and what it's not.
Yeah, absolutely. I think, Gautam, it's very important to understand what it is not. Starting point, it's not a pact. It is a logistic exchange memorandum of agreement. And it's a fairly basic agreement that the United States has with a number of other countries who are not military allies. So that is the second basic point, that this is not a pact. And this is an agreement that the United States enters into with countries who are not military allies, but with whom the U.S. has a fairly robust partnership. To that extent, the LEMOA, as it is called, will allow for both sides, as your report had pointed out, to be able to access each other's logistic train, meaning that if India were to, or any Indian military platform or unit, needs fuel, needs water, needs food, needs medical support, or any other aspect that comes under the logistic train. Mm-hmm. And they are not able to access the Indian tanker or the Indian logistic availability, mm-hmm. then the United States, if it is in a position, can provide this. Mm-hmm. And at the end of each year, you can balance the books.
Okay.
In the event the United States is able to avail of Indian logistics and vice versa. Mm-hmm. But clearly, the fact that India is a relatively smaller military power than the United States, I would say that we stand to gain or benefit more because mm-hmm. it enhances India's operational reach.
Okay.
Whether it's the maritime domain or we talk about the Indian Air Force, logistics is at the hub of how far you can operate and how far you can sustain your military presence.
Mm-hmm.
By entering into Lemoore,
especially in the Indo-Pacific region.
In the maritime domain, also I would say in relation to the Air Force.
Okay.
So what this is doing is it's an enabling provision. It does not make you a military alliance partner. Much less, as Minister Parikar clarified, no U.S. troops will be stationed in India.
Mm.
And even in the event that the United States embarks upon, say, a military operation in the region, it mm-hmm. could be a bandwidth of operations.
Okay.
India is not obligated to either support or get involved because mm-hmm. of Lemoore. That is the broad, I would say, template of this particular logistics.
Well, that makes it crystal clear. But as it is a foundational agreement, Shilkant Sharma. So just tell us, you know, it was 12 years in the pipeline. Why did it take so long? There were issues that were to be ironed out. All these things that needed to be specified that, you know, there are lines that will be drawn if and when need be, they will be drawn there.
Well, you know, it's ironical that an agreement has been done, or not agreement, but a memorandum of understanding has been signed.
Mm-hmm.
Because of the politics and the atmospherics which is there, we have to go out of our way to say what it is not, instead of saying what it does. This shows a kind of a undue concern, inordinate worry about a relationship which was the most defining relationship for India and its foreign policy mm-hmm. in this century,
mm-hmm.
ever since when they started working with the US in 2001 onwards.
Right.
So this 12 years have been now concluded with a good agreement, which is necessary for the U.S. system, because in their system, even when they say the best, a major defense partner, which means technology transfer and defense trade and technology initiative, which Mr. Ash Carter has been very forceful
yes.
about, for that to move forward, we'll have to work out the U.S. bureaucracy.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to work out the licensing arrangements. We have to get approvals.
Mm-hmm.
The difference it makes is that now there is a presumption of approval
okay.
in place of what used to be a presumption of denial.
Right.
But Lemoore helps a lot because it's a required congressional and legislative deal.
Okay.
Without that, we can't move forward.
Mm-hmm.
And as then explained by Commodore Uday Bhaskar, that it's a kind of a basic sine qua non.
Mm-hmm.
of two militaries working together, not for, there are many things which they work together, search and rescue, disaster relief, common operations,
mm-hmm.
for the peaceful kind.
Yes.
And so for that, for port visits, for, exchange of joint military exercises,
yes.
joint exchanges. For all this, you need services, you need supplies.
There's a high degree of interoperability now required because of joint exercises, multilateral joint exercises as well. But as far as India's military and strategic needs are concerned, in terms of its defense requirements, the need to be self-reliant in that area, and of course there's Make in India to create jobs and further resources, use them well, the human resource that we have. There are other foundation agreements that are required to be signed, right?
There are. There were totally three agreements, and the other two really relate to information protocols and certain amount of GPS data that was supposed to be shared. Now, India has, for reasons that the Ministry of Defense and the service headquarters had arrived at, chosen not to sign what is called as the SISMOA.
Okay.
Which is another very important agreement with the United
That's
States.
That's the communication and information.
And information exchanges and the protocols that define how you would ensure appropriate security of the information that the United States provides to you,
mm-hmm.
whether it's in relation to a platform, or it is in relation to this technology and trade initiative that is now being mooted. Mm-hmm. Now, in the wake of the scandal that we have over the Scorpion, okay, and the way in which there has been what is now being called as a data dump, mm-hmm, I think the concerns of the United States are not misplaced, meaning that if India is a recipient, mm-hmm, of any kind of high tech from the United States, mm-hmm, it must be able to establish its ability,
okay,
to ensure appropriate protection, mm-hmm, security, whether it is cyber or otherwise. So the SysMOA relates to what you might call as the next agreement that needs, mm-hmm, to be addressed. Personally, I would say that it would be in India's interest, because if on one hand you want to induct high technology into the Indian military, mm-hmm, across the board, ordnance, surveillance, lift, this, mm-hmm, is the classical tripod for any military. The United States represents the highest levels of technology.
Okay.
And I think if India wants to access them, we need to have the pipeline in place.
Mm-hmm.
And this particular agreement, the SysMOA, is part of that pipeline that will allow the, okay, information to move.
And without
and
it,
it's mandated, as Shield says, congressionally. Mm-hmm. It's a law. So we cannot expect that the United States will again,
mm-hmm,
change its law to, mm-hmm, accommodate India, because remember, they did it once.
Mm-hmm.
As far as the nuclear issue was concerned, but we were occupying the high ground there, meaning,
okay,
the US had introduced a law that was not equitable as far as India was concerned. That's a very complex history.
Mm.
But here, I think this is in our interest. And one line, if you allow me, Gautam, you were asking, why did it take so long?
Mm.
Because many of these things were mooted, as Ambassador Sharma said, in 2001 and 2. Mm. It is 2016, and we have only signed the first agreement,
yes,
now. As an analyst, I would say it was because of political diffidence,
okay,
during the UPA years,
mm-hmm,
and it was exacerbated, aggravated by the opposition. The BJP was then in the opposition.
Okay.
So let us not forget that Indian politics has not been conducive to India's national security imperative.
Mm-hmm.
I hope that changes. And when Minister Parikar comes back...
I guess that changed with the mandate
when Minister Parikar comes back, we should not have the same kind of, shall we say,
okay,
arid debates.
We,
that would be unfortunate.
Let's cross that bridge when we come to it. But to further understand what it really means, without these agreements, are you saying that if India wants advanced jet engines from the US, the licenses for those, or to buy Predator drones, that's not possible as of now?
Well, the highest levels of technology which are governed by SysMOA would not be available.
Okay.
I can give you a more simple example. For instance, now we have maritime reconnaissance aircraft. We paid a lot of money to get them from the United States, the P-8s.
Mm-hmm.
They come with a surveillance kit, you know, which is used for maritime domain awareness, for mapping the ocean,
mm-hmm,
also for anti-submarine operations.
Mm-hmm.
Because we have not signed the foundational agreements as far as information protocols are concerned,
mm-hmm,
we are unable to exploit the surveillance kit to the full, shall we say, extent,
okay,
possible.
Okay.
So in a way, we are accepting a shrunken,
mm-hmm,
military capacity for a platform that we,
okay,
paid a lot of money for,
mm-hmm,
because of the reticence to sign some of these foundational agreements. So that's the kind of, I would say, maturity or,
mm-hmm,
astuteness that we have to demonstrate,
okay,
as we engage with the United
States. But do you
States.
Think, Mr. Sharma, now that we have signed the LMOA, it would be relatively easier, and perhaps it will take lesser time in getting through with the signing of the other foundational agreements?
It depends upon how, our rebel rousers deal with this.
Okay.
Because as the minister returns and they start creating a fuss about it,
mm-hmm,
that will have its impact. But a wise counsel would be that we should move forward in all these agreements.
Okay.
I'll give you a parallel, these agreements are something like they belong to the software side,
mm-hmm,
of the hardware.
Okay.
And just as you have a computer, for instance,
mm-hmm,
you buy a Dell computer,
mm-hmm,
but if you don't get the operating systems,
mm-hmm,
and you start working on it, then you'll come across prompt boxes saying, please have this, this is not working, or they are not reading.
Mm-hmm.
So in the US-India cooperation,
mm-hmm,
Defense Technology and Trade Initiative is based on both hardware,
okay,
and the software. So software has not only the traditional meaning of software, which is computer software, etc.,
mm,
but also legal software.
Mm-hmm.
So this is part of the legal software without which
it's difficult to move forward.
They'll have to every time go to the Congress and say, we require this. Only one case can be where this thing moves forward is when we have common operations.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Now you can, after LMOA, you can think about common operations,
mm,
in search and rescue, relief operations,
mm-hmm,
disaster management, which are very necessary in our area.
Mm.
earthquake relief, for instance, or in the maritime zone, often the questions of search and rescue comes. So where, if we can do common operations, then for those, Lemua will be of great help.
Okay, and these end user monitoring conditions,
that is done already.
These don't really come in the way.
That is done.
And
user
verification
is done.
That's been already addressed.
Okay. We'll talk about what problems could arise once, as you were saying, the minister comes back in just a bit, because there are concerns there and those need to be addressed as well. We'll take a short break in late edition for the moment. Be back with a lot more. Stay tuned.
नए महिंद्रा यूवो का आरामदायक डिजाइन, यानी ना आप थकेंगे ना काम रुकेगा। महिंद्रा यूवो, ज्यादा जल्दी बेहतर।
These days, it's important to have an updated resume. Here's mine. Praful Kumar, Major Praful Kumar, Para Special Forces. 3 years served in a hostile zone. Tough assignment. Special service in JNK. Made some friends there. Combat free fall specialist. Willing to shed blood. As you can see, I wear my heart on my sleeve and my resume on my uniform. Which other company lets you do that?
We are India's most exciting workplace, and we are making you an offer. The Indian Army. Live a life less ordinary.
भाई बोले तो अपुन के एरिया में अपुन से बड़ा डेंजर कौन आ गया भाई?
डेंगू और चिकुनगुनिया।
बोले तो दोनों का गेम बजाते थे भाई।
अरे पापा, कूलर में मच्छर की फैक्ट्री डाले लाए क्या? ड्रम, कूलर, गमले, पक्षियों के बर्तन वगैरह को हर हफ्ते साफ करने का। टायर, प्लास्टिक के कप, ग्लास, नारियल के खोल में पानी जमाना होने दे। डेंगू और चिकुनगुनिया का मच्छर साफ पानी में पनपता है। मच्छर के काटने से बचे, बुखार हो तो पैरासिटामोल लेने का, एस्प्रिन नहीं।
पर भाई, ये बीमारी का पता कैसे चलेगा भाई?
सीधा है रे, बदन दर्द, सर दर्द, तेज बुखार, थकावट, बदन पे दाने निकले तो मतलब डॉक्टर को मिलने का, खुद डॉक्टर नहीं बनने का, समझा?
वाह भाई, आप तो सचमुच के MBBS हो भाई।
नया महिंद्रा यूवो दे 400 घंटे का लंबा सर्विस अंतराल, यानी साल में एक सर्विस की बचत। महिंद्रा यूवो, ज्यादा जल्दी बेहतर।
बचपन से ही मुझे पता था, I was a born leader, और इस बात का एहसास दिलाया मेरी पहली जॉब ने। वो सब सिखाया जो कोई और नौकरी नहीं सिखा सकती। मैन मैनेजमेंट, टाइम मैनेजमेंट, क्राइसिस मैनेजमेंट, सब कुछ। पहले ही दिन से मैं टीम को लीड कर रहा था, और जितने साल मैंने बिताए उससे कई ज्यादा एक्सपीरियंस मिला मुझे। और सबसे अच्छी बात, माय फर्स्ट जॉब मेड माय सेकंड करियर पॉसिबल।
हम है भारत के सबसे एक्साइटिंग वर्कप्लेस, और हम दे रहे हैं आपको एक ऑफर। भारतीय सेना, आम नहीं ये जिंदगी।
समझ क्यों नहीं रहे? वो बहुत परेशान करते हैं मुझे। रैगिंग के नाम पे टॉर्चर करते हैं।
सीनियर्स रैगिंग नहीं करेंगे तो तुम स्मार्ट कैसे बनोगे? तुम्हारा कॉन्फिडेंस कैसे बढ़ेगा? बी ए मैन।
आई एम सॉरी बेटा, आई एम रियली सॉरी।
आपके बच्चे की छोटी सी शिकायत किसी बड़ी मुसीबत का पैगाम हो सकती है। उसे नजरअंदाज ना करें। डोंट इग्नोर, टेक एक्शन।
Welcome back. You're watching Late Edition and talking about this agreement that has been signed between India and US, which takes forward their military ties even further. And we're talking about it with CEO Udaya Bhaskar and Sheel Kant Sharma, two well-known experts in their fields. And Sheel Kant Sharma, apart from the fact that this will make logistics exchange very easy between India and US, would it also help in their joint fight against terrorism?
Well, the joint fight against terrorism is a strategic understanding between India and US. That's the high point of kind of cooperation and mutual accord. This is the at the level of quotidian work.
Okay.
And so there's a gap between the two. The mm-hmm. Counterterrorism operation requires a whole host of things. It requires intelligence sharing, which is also happening. There are about 50 working groups, joint working groups, and bodies between India and US today, which are in operation. Mm-hmm. So if you were to get a glance of all of them, in a whole host of them cover counterterrorism.
Right.
But this is more connected with the defense cooperation.
Mm-hmm.
And so it is, as has been mentioned earlier, it's logistics. So it's more about daily or the exigencies of working together.
How would you weigh in on that, Commodore Udabhaskar?
Well, I would just say that if you look at Minister Parikar's visit to the US and his engagement with Dr. Carter, in many ways I'm reminded of 2005 when our Honorable President, Mr. Pranab Mukherjee, was the Defense Minister at that time. And in June 2005, India signed the first very comprehensive defense cooperation agreement with the United States when Mr. Rumsfeld was the Defense Secretary. And I would aver that the Carter-Parikar meeting of yesterday has the same kind of bandwidth in terms of what kind of areas have been identified. And in your report, Dr. Carter, I think, paused for a moment when he said that the fact that the United States has designated India now as a major defense partner is a very big deal. It is now for India to maximize this particular status, and this, I think, is a challenge. And here again, if you allow me, Gautam, I do want to highlight and acknowledge the role played by Dr. Ashton Carter.
Okay.
Because much of what has now been enabled, what has now been realized, is largely because of the heavy lifting that he has done personally, because the US bureaucracy, if I may say so, in the presence of Shilkant Sharma, a bureaucrat of great eminence, is no different from that of India, meaning that there are some very, very, I would say, it's a complex kind of a maze. And there were many reasons why the United States bureaucracy did not really want to be forthcoming with India.
Okay.
In the Pentagon, in the DOD, the Department of Defense. And Dr. Carter has worked at many levels before he's become the Defense Secretary. And I know from personal experience over the decades that he was committed to the Defense Technology and Trade Initiative. It has happened. And now we are also a major defense partner. So this particular visit is not just about Lemoa.
Right.
It has a wide bandwidth, and India, I think, should see how to maximize. And for that, again, if I could take the liberty of saying, we need to create more capacity on this side to engage with the United States. Because at the moment, the kind of interface we have, which is through the MEA, and a limited spectrum in the Ministry of Defense, I would again humbly submit, is not enough for the kind of volume and the quality of interaction that we are seeking with the United States to maximize major defense partner status, as also the defense trade and technology initiatives. Many of them
can
be played out in the maritime
domain. Looking at that, because that is an area that we want to press ahead on. But as far as people raising concerns about you saying the opposition could also rake it up, you know, when the minister comes back, because there are concerns here that this goes away from India's previous non-aligned strategy, where it had wriggled room to take advantage of the inter-competition of the big powers. Now, where it's being said that we're leaning more towards the US, is that also an incorrect assessment?
No, I think it's a non sequitur. This the whole whole business of bringing non-alignment in this context is a non sequitur, because today's context, you find major powers cooperating in many ways. They have, even despite the problem about Ukraine, for instance, there is increasing evidence that maybe US and Russia are cooperating on Syria, on fighting ISIS. So where is the kind of cold
war? Here specifically three countries are being named. One is Pakistan, of course, which has always worked up about anything that India does in terms of military progress. Then there's China, and then there's, of course, Russia.
No, but Russia and then US and China also have a set of cooperation ventures. So it is, the world is very different from the world in which non-alignment was born. So I think it is, there's a big, big disconnect.
Okay.
Now, the important thing for India is that this comprehensive relationship with the US, which is reflected by the fact that you have the Secretary of State here with Secretary of Commerce in Delhi, and the our Minister of Defense is in Washington. And all this is a coordinated approach to raising the relationship to a level just before the new leadership takes over in Washington.
Yes.
So we have to really consolidate the gains of all the works which have been underway over the last 5-6 years, and particularly accelerated ever since Prime Minister Modi came to office. So this is the time for us to really move forward, impart momentum, so that when the next team comes,
press on the pedal,
they can take, you know, take the baton.
At this there would time, be a momentum in any case.
This is
going
not
into
the time
next.
For doubting. You know, it's an English channel, but in the Gita it says, "Sanchayatma vinashati." Those who doubt die. So, you know, we have to be careful. We have to steer clear of these gratuitous doubts, you know, and move forward. What is very clearly possible for us to move forward. And, you know, you see, for instance, the joint statement for Raksha Mantri, it says they have set up new working groups on air systems, intelligence, surveillance and reconnaissance, chemical and biological protection, and other systems, and naval systems. So there's a whole...
It's comprehensive.
Whole bandwidth, you know. So the idea is to tap it and move forward.
Okay. I am completely out of time, Governor Udayabhaskar. I cannot come back to you. But clearly, this is an agreement that really opens doors for many other. And right now, of course, since the iron is hot, it's time to really go for it and ensure that India gets the kind of military capability that it aspires to, the kind of strategic depth that it wants, with all the help that it can get with its friends. Thanks for watching Late Edition tonight. Stay tuned to DD News for all the latest.